Thank you for checking out video number 3 of our new believer study. I pray that you are drawing closer to the Lord. Your faith is becoming stronger as you are hearing the Word of God and as you are walking out the things that He has in store for your life. Again, we want to tell you we are so proud of you. We are cheering for you. We are praying for you, and we are here for you since you have given your heart to the Lord. If you're checking out this video, you may have given your heart to the Lord recently for the very first time, or maybe you've rededicated your life to God here recently. We want to tell you again that God is with you and God loves you. The Bible says that He never leaves us nor forsakes us. He is with you in the midnight hour. He's with you when you wake up in the morning. He's walking with you every day. You keep pressing forward. You keep running after God and know that He has great things in store for you. And as you are seeking Him and you're seeking Him in His Word, we just pray that your faith becomes stronger and that even in these teachings over the last couple sessions and this session we're about to get into, we pray that the Word of God will just take up residency in your heart and that it will bear great fruit in you and through you. So here we go. We're going to jump right into session number 3 of our study here. And today's session is called Communicating with God. And we're going to be talking about some of the basics of prayer. And I want to tell you that prayer is so key. Prayer is so fundamental, but yet it is very powerful. Before we jump right into the depths of just prayer, let me say this to you, that there are a few key elements that are very basic to the Christian faith, but they are very basic, yet they are very powerful. They're elementary, but they're very deep. There are a few things that are so foundational that we have to continue to do and develop these spiritual habits in our life so that we can continue to grow, so that we continue to become stronger in our faith and the things of God and the purposes of God. And those few basic things are these right here. It's prayer, it's Bible study, Bible reading, it's attending church faithfully, and it's serving the body of Christ. It's getting involved in the ministry and the things of God. It's giving your time, your talent, your treasure. Serving does so much in our hearts. So the basics of Christianity are praying, it's reading God's Word, it's being committed to church, and it's beyond church. We are the church, but it's being connected to the body of Christ, finding our place in the body of Christ. God never intended for us to be connected from His body. He wants us to be involved in His church. He wants us to be faithful to His church. The Bible says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. That means it's a command. It means that when the church gathers together, that we don't take it lightly, we don't take it for granted, that we don't miss those times. Obviously, the church connects and we gather on the Lord's Day, on Sundays. And it's so important to be in the house of the Lord on Sundays. We know that church doesn't save us. Jesus saves us. But church is very important to our faith. Watch this. The Bible says that Jesus is the head of the church. He established the church. He is married to the church. He is the groom, and the body of Christ is His bride. The Bible says that He died for the church and that He is returning again for the church. So we understand that being a part of the church and being a part of the body of Christ is so vital and it's so important. Prayer, Bible study, being involved in the house of God and the church of God and serving in the body is going to be so vital, so important to your faith journey. It's going to strengthen you. Those are some of the foundational, elementary, basic things that we must continue to do in our journey, whether you've been saved for 5 minutes or you've been saved for 55 years. Those four basics are the things that we have to continue to have in our life so that we can continue to grow. And so today I want to teach you on the importance of prayer and what prayer is and how we can communicate with God and how important it is to communicate with God, and that we know that He hears our prayers, but we also position our heart so that we can hear Him speak to us. Because prayer is not just me talking to God, but prayer is also me listening to the heartbeat of God and Him speaking to our heart. And I want to tell you that He speaks every day. And when we align our heart and we make some adjustments so that we can hear His heart, He will speak to the depths of your spirit, and you will know that He is leading and guiding and speaking to you. So today, let's get right into our lesson. Lesson number 3 is communicating with God. As we turn the page, you will see at the top of your page here, it says, your prayer connection. At the very top, it says, communication and conversation are important in any relationship. Christianity is about relationship, a relationship with our Heavenly Father through a relationship with Jesus Christ. And watch this. Prayer is simply communication with God. It is a conversation with Him. Prayer is sharing what is in your heart with your Heavenly Father and allowing Him to share what He has in His heart with you. It is both speaking and it is also listening to God. Prayer keeps you connected with God and it feeds your spiritual growth. Without developing a habit of prayer, you become disconnected from Him. It is having, it is like having your spiritual phone on or off the hook, so to speak. And so it's so important that every day that we are communicating and talking with God. I want to share this with you, that prayer is the vehicle that God ordained, that He established, that we can communicate with Him. Prayer is simply communicating with God. It's not big words. It's not trying to speak big words out of the Bible. It's not about your volume, how loud you pray or how quiet you pray. Prayer is really just a heart matter, a sincere heart, where we come to the Lord and we speak to Him, we talk with Him, He will speak to us. I want to share this with you. These are side notes here. You can just write down on the side of your paper here. I want to tell you that I believe that it is important every day that we still waste some time where we communicate with God, whether it's early in the morning before we go to work or right after work or school, or late in the midnight hour when everyone goes to bed and you go and you spend some time alone with the Lord. I believe it's very important that we take, if it's a few moments or if it's 15 minutes or if it's an hour, whatever it is, that you can steal away and you get alone and you spend some time with the Lord. You pray and you talk with Him and you hear His heart and you worship Him. It's so vital, so important, because God is going to strengthen you through prayer. He's going to answer your prayers. He's going to speak to you about the direction of your life and strategy and insight in your personal walk, maybe strength for your spouse and how to lead your family. He's going to speak to you. I believe it's important that we spend time alone with God. But then number 2, there's a thing that the Bible talks about, prayer without ceasing. That means that we are in constant communication with the Lord throughout the day, that we're talking with Him throughout the day. It's kind of like, as an example, my wife and I, throughout the day, we text one another, we call one another periodically. Sometimes if we have something on our heart that we need to share, or there's something we need to talk about our kids and what time we're picking them up from an activity, we communicate throughout the day. Sometimes we just shoot out a text to one another and just say, hey, what are you up to right now? What are you doing? Or where are you? We're just communicating, connecting with one another. Praying without ceasing is doing that. It's driving down the road and saying, Lord, I love You today and I praise You and I just want to thank You for all the blessings in my life and I love You. Later in the day, reaching out to Him in your heart and saying, Father, is there anything in my heart that You want me to do? Is there anything that I need to change, or what's on Your heart today? Is there anyone that I can pray for today? Speak to my heart. Bring someone to my mind. Throughout the day, we're communicating with God. So there's a time that we steal away with God for a few moments or however long it is, and that we really get in there and we really pray to God. And then there, number two, there's the praying without cease, and that we're in constant communication with the Lord throughout the day and our hearts open to Him. These things are going to strengthen your faith. I want to tell you that prayer is not difficult. Prayer is not hard. I want to simplify it for you and you to understand that God hears you. He wants to hear your heart. Just talk to Him each and every day. Right there in the middle of your page, it asks this question: what is the first thought that comes to our mind when we hear the word prayer mentioned? For some, they have different feelings. Some folks feel guilt because they don't pray enough. Some feel frustration because they don't know how to pray. Some they have fear because they may not know how to pray, or they feel like their prayers aren't good enough, or God's upset with them. Listen, we have to eliminate all those feelings and those thoughts and know that when we are God's child, prayer is the vehicle to communicate with Him, and He wants to hear you. Listen, He has longed for you each and every day. He longs to spend time with you. Isn't that amazing that the Creator of the universe longs to spend time with you, and He will bless you when you spend time with Him? Turn with me in your page here. At the top, it says devoted to prayer. So how do you define the word devoted? That's a very important word, a key word. If you have a dictionary, take a moment, look it up, or write down your thoughts. Some of my personal thoughts that pop in my mind when I hear the word devoted, there are words that connect, that come to my heart. Words like committed, words like consecration, words like being faithful, being devoted. Those words are words that pop up in my mind when I hear the word devoted. So when we talk about being devoted to prayer, being committed to prayer, being faithful to prayer each and every day. Acts chapter number 2, verse 42, the early church, the Bible says this. This is the very beginning of church when Jesus established the church in the book of Acts. Chapter 2, verse 42, it says, and they continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. We have this question right here in the middle of our page. It says, what four things do the new believers, what did they devote themselves to? What did they commit themselves to? What were they faithful to do each and every day? Watch this. They were devoted to the doctrine of the apostles, the teachings that they received from Jesus Christ. Number two, fellowship with one another. That it's not God's will for you to do life alone. He wants you to connect to the body of Christ in fellowship and connection. Breaking of bread, they were connected heart and soul. They did life together. And then number four, in prayer. They were devoted to prayer every day, committed to spending time with God, the Heavenly Father. All believers should be devoted to the same things. We should be devoted to the Word, devoted to fellowship, devoted to prayer and the basics that God has for our life. When we do so, it's going to strengthen us. I want you to turn your page with me. At the very top here, it says, not just Father, but Daddy. I want to share this point with you. I want to teach this point. Have you ever thought about calling your Heavenly Father Daddy? Think about when a young child endearingly calls out Daddy. It speaks about the closeness of the relationship, not just the function of it. As I shared with you in the past session or two, that my wife and I, we have four children, and they don't just walk around and call me Father, and it's a hard relationship. Not that the word Father is a hard word. It depends on your definition and even your experience in your own life of some of these terms. But there's a very sincere and innocent and loving term that's connected to a dad or a father, and that is the word daddy. My four children, they call me daddy, especially my younger ones. They call me daddy, and it alludes and it speaks of the relationship, of the closeness there. There's an intimate, loving relationship of intimate hearts towards one another. Daddy, you know, the Bible says in Romans 8 and verse 15, it says, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. I want you to fill in that blank there in your study guide. Abba is spelled A-B-B-A. Watch this. The Greek word Abba is the same as the English word daddy. You are a child of God, adopted in His family. He is your Father, and God wants you to see Him as more than one who just saved you or protects you or provides for you, but He wants you to know His heart, that He loves you and that He wants a close relationship with you, that He is not only Lord, that He is not only God, but He is also our daddy. He is our Abba Father. He is our daddy. In other words, you can come to Him. You can come into His arms. He wants to embrace you. He wants to love you. He wants to strengthen you like a daddy does a young child. That's how much the Lord loves you. So when you come to the Lord, even in prayer, know that the relationship that He has laid out and that He desires is one of daddy and child. He cares for you and loves you more than you could ever imagine. You have the right to enter into His presence because of Jesus Christ and the price that He paid. Think about how powerful that is. In Hebrews chapter 10, right here in the middle of our page, we see the scripture. It says, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Because Jesus died on the cross, He made a way for us to come back to the Father. We now have the right, the privilege, and the honor, and the opportunity to enter right into the presence of God Himself, right into the arms of Abba Father, if we desire. So God's arms are wide open to you every day, ready for you to come and spend time with Him, and He will speak to your heart. John chapter 1 says this at the bottom of our page. The scripture is there. It says, and this is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, that He hears us. And if we know that He hears us, whatsoever we ask, when we know that we have the confidence that we desired of Him. Fill in that blank there with the word confidence. Because we have confidence in Christ, because we come to Him, and when we ask Him things according to His will, He hears us and He gives us confidence, knowing that He hears us and He answers our prayers. I love at the bottom of our page here, it says, God is always willing and eager to listen to you. He is never too busy for you, and He will answer your prayers when you ask in faith and according to His will. Matthew chapter number 6, we see that Jesus lays out a model prayer, and I'm going to end this session with this teaching here in this point. The Lord's Prayer. The Lord's Prayer is so famous. It is so important. It's so recognizable. Many people have the Lord's Prayer on plaques or posters, and some may have it highlighted in their Bible. It's very important. It's very vital. It's not so much that reading the Lord's Prayer absolutely changes our life, because it's not so much the repetition of the prayer, but it is the keys that are within the prayer that Jesus had laid out for us. He was sharing with the disciples and teaching His people in this time a model prayer. He wasn't saying repeat these exact words, but He was saying there is a model, there's principles laid out when we pray in this certain type of flow flow, when we have these elements included in our prayer and it comes from our heart, it is going to reach the heart of God, and God's going to respond with His goodness and His grace. So look at this. In Matthew chapter number 6, what is famously known as the Lord's Prayer, Jesus said this: when you pray, pray like this. He says, "Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." I love this model prayer because it's deeper than just repeating the words. Like I said, it's what's laid out, the principles and the flow of prayer. Watch this. Number one, he says, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name." In other words, there should be a time of worship and a time of adoration. When we pray and we come to the Father, when we come to Abba Father, our Daddy, there should be a time in our prayer where at the beginning we recognize Him. As an example, when we come to prayer right out of the gate, we say, "Lord, I love you and I praise you and I honor you today. I recognize your authority and your power. I know you sit on the throne, you sit high and you look low, and all power is in your hands. I worship you and I honor you today, and I set my heart on you, God. Where would I be if it wasn't for you?" When we begin to pray these things, we begin to set our affection on Him. We begin to worship Him. We begin to recognize His authority. We begin to recognize, and we lay out the key here, that hallowed be your name. We recognize His power and His authority. Number two, he says, pray like this: "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." When we begin to pray, we begin to move in and we say, "Lord, let your will be done on the earth." What is your plans today, God? What is your heart today? God, what is it that you want me to do? Where do you want me to be, God? Who do you want me to speak to? Who do you want me to pray for today? Let your will be done in my life. Let your will be done in this earth as it is in heaven. What is on your agenda, God? What is on your docket? What's on your plan today, God? I want your will to be done in my life. That's the next phase of prayer that opens up our hearts to Him. Then he says, "Give us today our daily bread." This right here encourages us that we can come to Him with our own request. We come to Him and ask Him to fulfill our own needs. As an example, we ask Him, "Lord, provide for me today, Lord, protection and provision and strength and counsel. Holy Spirit, speak to me." We pray, "God, heal my brother, heal my sister, or bring a financial breakthrough to my friends or my family members. Lord, I have need of you. I need you to do this and I need you to do that. Give us today our daily bread." We can come to Him and make our requests known. The Bible says that we can make our requests known unto Him. So that's the next part of prayer. Then he says, "Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us." Jesus teaches the importance of forgiveness, but it also, he is alluding to the fact that we also pray every day, "Lord, if there's anything in me that's unlike you, if there's anything that's displeasing to you, I ask you to forgive me. I ask you to cleanse my heart today. I ask you to cleanse my mind, cleanse my actions, cleanse my words and my thoughts and the things that I've done. Anything I said or did or looked at or any way I treated someone yesterday or even last night or this morning that's displeasing to you. Lord, forgive me of my sins and my debts as I have forgiven others. Cleanse my heart." And then he says, "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." We begin to pray that the Lord would lead us and guide us and strengthen us, that He would empower us each and every day, that He would guide our footsteps and guide our path and keep our foot from evil and our ways from evil, that He would strengthen us in the times of temptation. salvation. I want to share with you that every day, goodness and mercy follow you. That's what Psalm 23 says, that God has grace for you each and every day, that His mercies are brand new each and every morning, the Word declares. And watch this, grace is unmerited favor. It's blessings that you don't even deserve. But there's another definition of grace that's not taught very often, but grace also means divine empowerment. God will give you a grace. He will extend grace to you and I when we make mistakes and fall. He will pick us up again. But He also gives us a grace every day to overcome evil, to overcome struggle and temptation. A divine empowerment. There is a grace upon you every day to overcome your old lifestyle, your old sins, your old habits, the old temptations that try to pull on you. God can deliver you from evil. He can give you a grace every day so that you don't fall and struggle in those old things. You have grace, divine empowerment to overcome those things. And when we pray, Lord, deliver me from temptation, from the evil. Lead me not into temptation. He strengthens us. So those are some key elements to prayer. When you pray, when you read the Word of God every day, whether it's one scripture or a passage, get in the Word of God every day. Be faithful to the house of God. Don't miss church. Get in here because there's strength and there's power that's released. There's encouragement released in our hearts when we gather and we hear the Word of God. It strengthens our faith. Number four, serve somewhere. Get on a ministry team. Be part of the ushers, the greeters, work in children's ministry. Whatever you can do, get right in there because these basics are going to strengthen your faith journey. So thank you for checking out session number three. Let's get ready for session number four. And again, I pray that your faith and your strength is stirred up in Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you.